advantage of dealing with folks the old-fashioned way. When you order printed material on the internet, you're stuck with what you get. But when you need printed material to look just right, you want to deal with folks you know. And that's what you'll find at Panhandle Printing and Design. Local folks that have been delivering results for years. They can help with everything from design to production of stationery envelopes, business cards, invitations, vinyl signs, banners, vehicle wraps, and a lot more. They can answer all your printing questions, and you can call them on the phone or hop on your horse and go see them, because they're your one-stop printing shop where they have something for everyone. Panhandle Printing and Design at 124 North Maple Avenue in Martinsburg. Call 304-267-7400. You can even find them online, too, if you want to. If you need printed materials, don't deal with some city slicker you'll never meet. Trust the folks at Panhandle Printing and Design.
Downtown Martinsburg is the place to be for the Fridays at 5 Summer Concert Series from June 1st through August 31st. Enjoy great music and fun with well-known musicians, bands, and Martinsburg artists that will liven up your spirits at the town square. Concerts begin at 5 p.m. and usually last until 7. Enjoy great music while visiting Martinsburg's Farmers Market, housed on East King Street, where you're able to enjoy fresh fruits and veggies, chicken and pork, and a lot more. Pets are allowed in the square during the concerts, provided they're on a 6-foot leash or less. For the full concert summer series lineup, go to MainStreetMartinsburg.com. Simply free e-checking from City National Bank. Perfect if you want basic checking with no monthly service fees or balance requirements. Stop by any of our 7 Eastern Panhandle locations or visit us online at bankatcity.com. City National Bank, member FDIC, equal housing lender.
Possibilities are all around us. We see potential in unexpected places. And when we share our knowledge, vision, and connections, we turn great ideas into action in communities all around the world. Together, we can make real change happen. We're Rotary. We are people of action. Get involved at Rotary.org.
With 4 new car dealerships and 4 used car dealerships in 3 states, Parsons is the largest used car and fastest-growing new car dealer in the tri-state area. Take Parsons Ford. With huge savings on hundreds of new Fords, financing from 0%, Parsons' goal of financing for all, and Parsons' famous above-market trade-in allowances that help make Parsons number one for used cars, too. See why so many won't buy anywhere but Parsons Ford in Martinsburg. We became number one by making you number one first. Parsons.
Talk Radio WRNR Studios. It's time for Eastern Panhandle Talk with Rob Mario and David Welch.
Thank you, Cliff. Good morning and welcome to the program. Eastern Panhandle Talk with Rob and Dave, brought to you in this first segment by the Washington Nationals. Wake up, brush your teeth, eat breakfast, pick your guy, beat the streak.
I knew I forgot something today.
Download Beat the Streak in the App Store or on MLB.com/BTS and add Beat the Streak to your morning routine, Dave. Beat the Streak. Speaking of baseball.
What are you even talking about this morning?
I just read what the sponsors tell me to read, Dave.
Okay.
And the Washington Nationals are a sponsor.
Oh,
I see. They tell me to read today.
Okay. All right.
Speaking of which, by the way, Bob Rizzo.
My buddy Bob.
As we know, super fan Bob Rizzo.
Yeah.
Sent to me the all-time Italian team as selected by Robert J. Rizzo for the Hall of Fame.
Baseball. Is that right? Baseball.
Baseball players and umpires.
Oh, really? Umpires.
The manager
who
is...
Who knows the names of umpires?
He knows the Italian names. Art Passarella, Joe Paparella, Frank Pulli, and Louis DeMuro.
Those are the umpires?
Those are the umpires. The okay. manager is Yogi Berra.
Wait, did it have anything to do with their skill or ability as umpires? Or
well, this is the Italian Hall of Fame. You have to be Italian. That's qualification number one.
I get that. Okay. Do they have to be good, though, too?
Is there a good umpire?
Well, good point. I would imagine there is.
I can tell you, as a football coach at the high school level now, I despise all high school referees in Maryland. I do. I can't. There's not one of my like.
That is not teaching your students good values.
I don't tell them that. I keep.
They might be listening to the show.
They're not listening to the show. They're in school.
Okay.
And the ones that aren't are graduating seniors, so.
Mm-hmm. It won't matter. They'll learn soon enough.
I watch game film all day Saturday of our game, and I, at the end of the game, I just hate everybody. I hate people who work at Foot Locker. That's how much I hate officials by the end of Saturday. If you work at Foot Locker, I would walk up to you and go, I don't like you, just because you have a striped shirt on. Here are some of the baseball players. Tommy Lasorda and Joe Malfitano are the assistant coaches there.
Oh, I like that.
All right. Let's see. Phil Cavaretta, Frank Polici, Frank Rossetti, Joe Torre, Johnny Rizzo, Joe DiMaggio.
Oh, yeah. Joe has to be on there.
Carl Furillo, Ernie Lombardi, Gus Mancuso, Joe Garagiola, Dom and Vince DiMaggio, Rocky Colavito, Tony Lazzari, Sal Bando. You remember from the
Sal
other
Sal Bando from the A, sure.
Dolph Camilli.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Pitchers are Marius Russo, Vic Lombardi, Ernie Abrolio, Vic Rashi, John Candelaria, who I didn't know John was Italian, Johnny Antonelli, and John Montefusco, as in the Count of Montefusco. That's from Bob Rizzo.
All right. Bob would know. I wonder, Bob, let me know how long you worked on that. You know what he did. He just ran he probably just ran a computer and looked for vowels at the end of names and put them all on.
I don't know. Bob's been around a while. He would know.
Were there any Italians who played baseball not on that list? I guess there were.
Frank Torre. I didn't hear Frank Torre's name. Yeah. Frank Torre played baseball.
He's got Dom DiMaggio on there. Is that a good pick?
Vince.
Did he have
Dom and Joe DiMaggio. The DiMaggio brothers.
All of them.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Any Pittsburgh guys?
Yeah. One of the DiMaggios played for the Pirates. Vince or Dom. I can't remember.
All right. Well, you know where they're from, don't you?
The DiMaggios?
Yeah. They're from San Francisco.
Yeah, I guess they are.
Yeah, he was a star in the old PCL league before they expanded to Major League Baseball out there, way before, actually, because they didn't expand to the West Coast until the late 50s. But back in the day, before the day of airplanes, the Pacific Coast League was essentially the West Coast's Major League.
Sure, because there were no
major teams there. Drew big AAA, drew big crowds. They still do okay out there, you know, as AAA goes. But back then, you had these stars, and the major leagues would go draft a great deal of their players out of the Pacific Coast League and actually buy them. They'd buy their contracts from the minor league teams.
They say it's easier to hit home runs in the PCL than the other minor leagues. Ball carries better.
Lighter air, I suppose.
Yeah.
Yeah, that might have something to do with it. More arid, less humid. Makes sense.
Big show today.
Scientifically. Yeah, we do have a big show today. We kind of skip all over the place.
Dale Lee from the West Virginia Education Association will be on in the 9 o'clock hour. In this first segment, S. Chris Anders from the Campaign for Liberty joins us courtesy of the WU Medicine Berkeley Medical Center talk line. Good morning, Chris.
Good morning, Rob. How are you this morning?
Awesome. Can't complain, man. How about you?
Oh, just busy, busy, busy as always. Nonstop. We've gone from the West Virginia primaries. Now we're in the Virginia primaries and the Medicaid expansion fight. The vote's going down in the the Virginia capital today.
You know,
so
I hear there's
no rest for the wicked.
I hear there's a possibility they could shut down Virginia state government over this. Chris, is that accurate?
Well, that's typical of what the leftists do. If they don't get what they want, they shut down the government, and the conservatives just fold. It's a bluff they always use, and we need to call their bluff, because the Medicaid expansion under Obamacare in Virginia would do exactly what it did in West Virginia, which would cause all the PEIA problems. It causes a tremendous increase to everybody's personal insurance premiums. And causes taxes to go up. Right now, they're looking at close to $700 million in new taxes in Virginia to cover this expansion. The whole ball of wax comes down to two Virginia state senators, whether or not they're going to flip and vote for the expansion. So this has been it's interesting how in Virginia, with the House of Delegates controlled by the Republicans and the Senate controlled by the Republicans, they're still folding under on this issue. So, I've been brought over into Virginia to fight on the task force to try to keep it from happening, or else we'll end up seeing what happened in West Virginia with all the issues and possibly, school funding being at risk, roads being at risk, just to expand socialized medicine. So, so no rest for the wicked for me,
Chris,
busy, busy, busy.
Hold on a second there. David, give me that. Give that to me.
I like it.
Give it to me now.
It relieves tension.
Welch is playing with a fidget spinner. Give that to me now. I'm taking it away.
Well, you take every... then give me...
That's a fidget spinner.
Then, yes. Then give me the woodpecker.
No, you're not getting the woodpecker.
You take all my toys away.
What was your teacher's day like when you were in second grade?
Oh, you have no idea.
I get the feeling this is what it was
you
like.
You have no idea.
David, give that pencil to me.
I'm quite sure.
Let that girl's hair alone.
And at the dinner table, yes.
This is... Hey, concentrate and focus on our guest.
Lifelong fidgeter.
We go from talking about Obamacare to fidget spinners. It's a fun morning.
Chris, I can't control him. I'm sorry about that. He clearly created that. I was doing nothing that should have disturbed him at all.
You're sitting there spinning, and I can hear the noises you're making trying to get the fidget spinner.
Oh, I didn't know you
faster.
Could hear the noise.
Yes.
I thought I was being silent.
No.
Well, in that case, I understand.
All right, so that's what's going on in Virginia, and you're saying they're taking the vote today. Have they considered what happened in West Virginia at all as they're considering their votes in Virginia?
We are doing our absolute best to be sure they do. We are doing our absolute best, considering also that there's a new plan coming out on June 15th from the Trump administration that will actually, my understanding is that the bill will get rid of the federal funding for the for the states that have expanded Medicare Medicaid under Obamacare, and actually reward those states who didn't. We're trying to get those details out to the different senators as well. So there's a lot of balls in the air, and it's really interesting. Besides that, you also have the red flag law fight that's starting to go down across the country, that we're fighting against these unconstitutional red flag laws. So there's a lot going on, and we're always wondering now that we've moved past the primary in West Virginia, will Republicans stand firm on their vow to defend the Second Amendment, or will they come out and start supporting these unconstitutional red flag laws?
What's a red flag law? I missed that.
Well, the red flag law is very much like the Fix Nicks bill that went through, and part of the omnibus spending bill that not only increases our debt to $21 trillion, but what it basically does, red flag laws empower unelected bureaucrats, whether they be in the Veterans Administration, Social Security Administration, or one of the many alphabet agencies of government, to identify people they view as a risk and unconstitutionally, without their day in court, put them on a no-buy list for firearms. In other words, if a federal bureaucrat buried deep in the bowels of Washington, D.C., doesn't think that you should be able to buy a firearm, they can put you on a no-buy list like they have the no-fly list, without your day in court, which is clearly unconstitutional. Under the Fifth Amendment, you have your right to your life, liberty, and property unless you are found guilty in a court of law. And it also, of course, violates the Second Amendment, which is the right to keep and bear arms. And I'm wondering, how that's going to play into the West Virginia general election, because when you look at like the U.S. Senate race in West Virginia, where you had Evan Jenkins, who supported Fix Nicks, and which basically did the same thing. It gave hundreds of millions of dollars to federal bureaucrats to put veterans and those who get Social Security on a no-buy list. We had a lot of grassroots groups, whether it be the National Association for Gun Rights, the West Virginia Liberty Political Action Committee, Campaign for Liberty, and others, informing voters all over the state about Jenkins' unconstitutional vote. And I think that actually showed up at the polls. Because if you have someone who's voting away your constitutional rights because some bureaucrat somewhere thinks you shouldn't have them, we don't have kings anymore. We are a free and independent people, and you have all your rights and liberty unless you're judged in a court of law to be incompetent. So it's going to be interesting how this plays out in the general election, because I know that Joe Manchin supports red flag laws. He's teaming up with Marco Rubio and, of all people, Lindsey Graham of South Carolina in the U.S. Senate to try to push these laws through. So it's going to be really interesting where Patrick Morrisey goes on this campaign, whether he chooses to stand with the Fifth Amendment and the Second Amendment, or if he chooses to kind of go along with the current public, idea that bureaucrats are made of finer clay than we the people, and can take away your constitutional rights.
Chris, there's something fishy about this, though. That you're saying that a low-level member of the federal government, by him or herself, can simply put me on a no-buy list for no reason, or does there have to be a reason?
Well, I mean, they can come up with a million reasons, and I'm sure they have.
What would some of those reasons be? In your mind, some of the more ridiculous reasons. I mean, a traffic ticket.
I've heard everything from a traffic ticket to, you know, and it hasn't really fleshed itself out yet. They're just empowering these people to do so, and they haven't really come up with the procedure that they would. But either way, it's completely, clearly unconstitutional. For example, like my grandfather, who has passed on now, when he was older, my mother was put in charge of him as far as, you know, managing his finances. When he'd get a Social Security check, she was on his bank account, right? And what they're saying is those people shouldn't be allowed to own guns, right? Even though he was a law-abiding citizen, had hunted all his life, had absolutely no background, you know, a record of any type of violent offenses, they're saying, well, if they can't manage their finances, then they shouldn't be able to own a gun. But that's still, it's unconstitutional. You have your right to face your accuser in court. You have your day in court, right, before they can take away, you know, your liberty or your possessions. And that's very important. We can't go around saying, well, we'll, you know, go around the Constitution for this or we'll go around it for that. I mean, you know, the Founding Fathers faced this when the British decided that no one should have firearms in Lexington and Concord and sent people to seize them without their day in court. Which is why our Founding Fathers put these very clear clauses in the Constitution to protect your inherent rights. You already have these rights. The Constitution and government does not grant these to you. What it does is it protects your already inherent human rights.
Well, let me follow up on that, because we have, with the school shootings that have taken place, the aftermath of at least a couple where we've seen social media postings that would indicate that this person is not stable, and some postings in which they flat out stated their goal is to kill people and as many as possible. So if I'm a bureaucrat in charge of monitoring social media and I see that statement, are you saying that I should not have the right to react to that statement and confiscate that person's guns to prevent them from doing something they say they intend to do?
Well, there is due process with this. It's very simple. You know, especially when it's family members who are throwing up these red flags, very simple. Take them to court. Take them to court immediately. You would get a court hearing right away on an issue like this, but at least you'd be following due process, because we'll get to a point where people are monitoring everyone's social media, as we saw with Roseanne Barr and a few other. I mean, anything you say now, you're put on public trial rather than a real, you know, court. And, you know, you could get to the point where I don't like my neighbor, so I'm going to call in and say that my neighbor is a threat, and then the SWAT team shows up.
Okay, but we kind of have that now already. That's not any different than it's been since telephones were invented. I'm talking about, if I'm in charge of monitoring social media, and let's say I'm quasi-law enforcement, and I see that David Welch posts on his Facebook page, I'm going down to this school and I'm going to shoot people. Well, you want me to take him to court, or I shouldn't be reacting swiftly and sending police to his house right now, as he has publicly stated, I'm going to kill people at a school, and I'm going to do it today?
Publicly stated he's going to kill people at a school, you know, that clearly shows intent. And then you call the police.
Yes,
you call the police at that point.
Okay.
And they can be sure that they're not.
So you're not objecting to that. But you're not objecting to that.
No, I'm not objecting to that. I'm objecting to the point that they're taking away people's you know, civil liberties under the Constitution without their day in court. In other words, what they're planning on is passing something. Let's say that you would decide that David, you know, David did something. He bought a car from you and he didn't pay you the full amount, so now you're going to get even with him. And you call in and you complain to these federal bureaucrats, who immediately dispatch the police. David's guns are taken away. Then he has to pay out of his own pocket thousands of dollars to hire attorneys to get them back. There's something clearly wrong with that.
I don't disagree with that.
Burden of proof on the state. The burden of, before you can lose your constitutional rights, you have to be judged guilty. You have the burden of proof has to be on the state.
I don't disagree with that.
Chris, is the Campaign for Liberty intending to challenge the so-called red flag laws in court and take that to court to end it, or does that require congressional or state legislative action?
We are looking more. They haven't passed yet. We're trying to stop them from passing.
I see. Okay, gotcha.
They've already passed in Maryland. Of course, we expect such out of the state of Maryland. The People's Republic of Maryland is how I refer to it. It's truly Maryland has, you know, I have hunting ground in Maryland that I inherited from my grandfather, but I would never live in Maryland, right, because the laws have gone so far to the left. And so it's fighting it state to state, and unfortunately it looks like we're going to have to fight it on the national stage. And when you have all the emotion and all the people getting swept up in the emotion of the moment, they're not, you have to govern logically. You have to govern by the law of the land. You cannot just end run the law of the land. If you don't like the Fifth Amendment, then you need to repeal it. You can't just end run it. Does that make sense? And that's what's happening a lot, and that's what's happened in America for a long time, is we just kind of, well, the Constitution says this, but we're going to pass a law that says something else. I'm sorry, the Constitution trumps any law that is passed, and we have way too many activist judges out there who are circumventing the Constitution when their primary job is to defend it, and that implies to politicians as well.
Chris Andrews is our guest here on Eastern Panhandle Talk with Rob and Dave. He is with the Campaign for Liberty and appearing courtesy of the WVU Medicine Jefferson Medical Center talk line.
Hey, Chris, we don't have a lot of time left, but size up this Senate race for us here. You've got, obviously, Morrissey on the Republican side, the incumbent Joe Manchin running for re-election, and then you've got this guy named Blankenship kind of coming in as a third-party candidate. What do you see here in November?
Well, as far as Blankenship, I mean, West Virginia has sore loser laws. Okay, you cannot run as a major party candidate and then turn around and be upset at the fact that you lost and run as a spoiler as a third-party candidate. As far as looking at the Morrissey-Manchin race, it's going to be really interesting. It's going to put a lot of heat on Manchin on his voting over the next couple months because there's a lot of hot issues coming up in Congress, whether it's going to be the repeal of Obamacare Part 7 at this point, or red flag laws. I really see that Joe's Manchin really doesn't have a base at this point because he's wandered so far to the left on some things. He's wandered so far to the right. I think if Patrick Morrissey sticks to his constitutional roots and sticks to his, dare I say, guns, he can win this race. I really think it's winnable. I don't see Blankenship being allowed to file as a third-party candidate.
Is there a court case on that, Chris, that you're aware of?
He's threatening to file one, whether one's been filed or not. I mean, we have an example in Jefferson County where clearly, if there should be, a candidate running on a third party, it would be in the Jefferson County Commission race that Jane Tabb won by convincing close to 200 Democrats to switch parties and vote in the Republican primary, and she won the primary by like 35 votes.
That was a brilliant move, don't you think, on her part?
Brilliant and completely unethical. We knew she was doing that. We knew that she was going out and enlisting Democrats to switch parties. But that kind of really violates the integrity of a primary election. Some states like West Virginia have semi-closed primaries. Some states have closed primaries. And some states like Virginia have open primaries where nobody registers by political party. I think this is something we have to look at. It happened to McDaniels, who was running for U.S. Senate down in North Carolina, where with the runoff, his opponent, Tad Cochran, went to all the Democrats and convinced them to show up to vote for him in the Republican primary. So if you are going to have a Republican primary, it should be a Republican primary. If you don't have open primaries, fine.
I don't disagree with that.
Well,
Chris, we're out of time. Thanks so much for yours this morning. Much appreciated.
Oh, absolutely. You gentlemen have a wonderful morning. Enjoy your discussion of baseball, and otherwise known as Rounders.
That's right.
Hope you guys have a great day. All right?
You too, sir. 8:31. Our news break is coming up next.
News update. Roseanne Barr was up late tweeting about her dismissal from ABC, which dropped her popular sitcom revival after the comedian's racist attack on a former Obama administration advisor. More from CBS's Vladimir Duthier.
She essentially spent the entire night tweeting, even though she suggested that she was getting off Twitter. And she just went on a tweet storm, ultimately, though, telling those who were sort of supporting her that they shouldn't defend her, that she took some Ambien, but that she shouldn't be defended, that she did something wrong, and her supporters should just let it be.
Roseanne was dismissed after comparing Valerie Jarrett to a cross between the Muslim Brotherhood and an ape. Jarrett tells MSNBC she got a call from the CEO of ABC's parent company, Bob Iger.
He apologized. He said that he had zero tolerance for that sort of racist, bigoted comment, and he wanted me to know before he made it public that he was canceling his show.
CBS News Update. I'm Deborah Rodriguez.
Now your local news from Talk Radio WRNR. The Jefferson County Sheriff's Department was awarded the top enforcing office in the state at Governor Jim Justice's Highway Safety Conference last week. Last year, the sheriff's office arrested just under 300 impaired drivers. Five Jefferson County deputies were also recognized during the conference as being among the top 52 law enforcement officers in the state. Martinsburg has the second highest gasoline price this week at the West Virginia metro area surveyed for the AAA East Central fuel gauge at about $2.99 per gallon. Clarksburg has the highest price at about $3, and Parkersburg has the lowest at about $2.68. The average of the eight West Virginia metro areas is about $2.91, 6 cents higher than last week. Some summer grilling tips from the West Virginia Region American Red Cross. Always supervise the grill. Keep it out in the open, away from the house, the deck, tree branches, or anything else that could catch fire. I'm Adam Boardman, Talk Radio WRNR News.
Our last few days of May, definitely all about a summertime look and feel, as we've got a weather pattern very typical of June, July. Lots of humidity coming up out of the south. We've got a warm front that'll be coming through here during the daytime today. That'll kick off some rain in the afternoon, especially some showers and thundershowers more likely then, and a high temperature close to 80 degrees. Overnight, a lingering shower or thundershower, especially before midnight, with lows close to 68. And then tomorrow, on the warmer side of the front, more numerous showers and thunderstorms again, primarily early afternoon. Daytime high lower 80s. Muggy on Friday, partly sunny, highs upper 80s. I'm Bob Kukin, Talk Radio WRNR.
Join us at WVU Medicine Jefferson Medical Center Saturday, June 2nd, 10 to 2 for the 6th annual Community Baby Shower and Diaper Drive. This free educational event is for expecting and new parents to learn about all aspects of pregnancy from birth to baby and beyond. Meet with Jefferson Medical Center experts, take a tour of the OB unit. Plus, there will be refreshments, door prizes, and ultrasound photos for our pregnant guests. Bring a pack of diapers along for our diaper drive at the Community Baby Shower and Diaper Drive at Jefferson Medical Center in Ranson.
This is Joe Ferretti of Hammer, Ferretti & Schiavone. The laws are changing drastically in West Virginia, and more than ever, you'll need an attorney with a reputation and a history of good results handling your personal injury claim. At my law firm, each attorney has at least 28 years of experience winning cases. Ask about our reputation and history of proven results. We know these comparisons will convince you to call Hammer, Ferretti & Schiavone at 264-8505. Call for a free meeting to discuss your case. And of course, you can find us on the web at hfslawyers.com.
Hi, honey.
Where are you?
I've been in line at the post office for the last 30 minutes.
Why are you at the post office? It'll take you all day.
Where else do I go to ship my packages or drop FedEx off at?
Honey, going postal is way faster, has less lines, and friendly service.
Where's going postal?
It's right in the Common Shopping Center in Martinsburg. They'll ship your packages quickly, and you can avoid the lines.
Going postal should be your first choice for all your shipping needs. Going postal, the Commons, Martinsburg.
The Honda Memorial Day sales event has brilliant deals on our most popular vehicles, like the Civic, Fit, and Pilot. It's the perfect way to start summer across America. From the Liberty Bell to Hollywood, and even back up to Niagara Falls. So start your summer with the 2018 KBB.com best overall brand during the Honda Memorial Day sales event. Now at your Honda dealer.
Miller Honda south of Winchester, home of the lifetime powertrain warranty. www.mymillerhonda.com.
Based on 2018 brand image awards from Kelley Blue Book, visit KBB.com for more information.
Welcome Welcome back to the program. Eastern Panhandle Talk with Rob and Dave in the 8:30 segment, brought to you this morning by Miller Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram, Route 9 east of Martinsburg home. All of the lifetime powertrain warranty. 304-263-6540 and 304-263-6586. Our telephone numbers if you'd like to be a part of the program today. And coming up in the 9 o'clock hour, West Virginia Education Association President Dale Lee will be with us. And then after Dale, we'll speak with Ken Apple, CPA, and we'll talk about how the new tax laws will affect you for 2019 and some things you might be doing now while we're in the middle of the year.
Because of the changes in the tax laws.
Because of the changes.
Yeah.
And a lot of the effects of the tax law will be based on what state you live in, too.
Well, that's
something
true.
Else to consider.
Yeah, it will indeed. And whether you live in a high property tax state or a low property tax state, I would imagine that would be the main difference.
Correct.
So I live in a low property tax state. You live in a high property tax state.
Well, I do.
And I don't mind the government taking your money.
I know you don't.
No, I really don't.
As a matter of fact,
I think you should feel good about that.
You've written letters that they should take more of my money
to
Annapolis, as I recall.
In fact, what I really like is spending 98% of my commute on Maryland highways that I don't have to pay for. That's a good thing, don't you think?
I think it's a great thing for you.
Whatever. Hey, by the way, before we let this one thing go, I wanted to make this point when Chris was still on, and he referred to Jane Tabb's strategy in that Jefferson County election of recruiting a couple of hundred Democrats to re-register as independents so they could go to the general to the primary election and vote her in back into office. Mm-hmm. I called that a brilliant strategy. He called it unethical.
Yes.
And I see his point, by the way. Mm-hmm. But it's I also think that that same rule kind of applies to when, and we saw this a lot in the U.S. Senate primary, where members or organized members of the other party come in to influence the other party's election. Brilliant strategy, nothing illegal about it, but in my mind, unethical. So there are a lot of things in politics that go on that aren't illegal. No one's breaking a law. Mm-hmm. They can fall into that brilliant strategy category, but clearly unethical, at least the way I think of things.
There's a lot of things in life like that, right?
In politics especially.
Yeah, man.
Yeah.
As we were talking about tax law and tax changes and how that might affect how you address certain things during your year, and some of those might be charitable contributions. So, with the new tax law now in effect, as we're at the end of May, by 5 months, we decided to reach out to Michael Whalton, the executive director of the Eastern West Virginia Community Foundation, and bring him in to address this topic and more. Michael, good morning to you.
Good morning, Rob.
Great to see you again.
Thanks very much for having me.
Might I say you always look dapper, sir.
Well, thank you.
Well-dressed.
I look good on radio.
Well, and now on TV, too.
And I'll bet Michael, there's not a doubt in my mind that Michael is a slippers guy. Do you wear slippers at home?
We had this debate previously, Michael. Do you do slippers?
Thousands of people weighed in on this. There's only two kinds of men in the world, those that wear slippers at home and those that don't. I do. He doesn't.
So. Well, I mean, if it's cold, I'll wear slippers.
So you're a slippers guy. Okay.
Yeah, okay.
There you go. Oh, sure. In summertime, we kind of put those away, I think. Yeah.
I'm not a slippers guy.
I know you're not.
Therefore, I'm outnumbered today, 2-1.
So when you go outside with the dog, what do you wear? Yeah.
Shoes.
Okay.
What else would you wear? Yeah.
Slippers.
Shoes.
Yeah.
What if you go out in slippers, what if the sole of the slipper is not strong enough and you step on a nail? Now what do you got?
Well, I'm not going out where they're boards with nails on them.
Well, but you never know where there's a nail. That's the thing about a nail. Nobody intentionally walks on a nail.
See, what I do is I buy a new
except
pair.
For those guys on like the Wild World of Sports who rest on a bed of them.
Now, I buy moccasin slippers, but I buy a new pair at the beginning of every winter. Then I take last year's and I put those outside the garage door so I can wear those outside and keep my indoor slippers inside.
This is way too deep for me.
Yeah. No, but these are the important things we talk about here on the show, Michael. You know that. We get right to the bottom of things here.
Your feet.
Your feet.
That's the very bottom.
The very bottom.
Can't get more bottom than that.
That's exactly right.
Michael, let's talk about the Eastern West Virginia Community Foundation. How much in funds right now is the foundation managing?
We have just over $23 million in assets.
And how has that grown over the last couple of years?
We've had some great years. We had growth of about 15% last year, about 8% the year before. We're averaging, even with, when you factor 2008 in, we still are looking at close to 8% annual returns over the long haul. So we're doing very well. And that's just because we don't look at the markets at a, on a daily basis. We are investing in perpetuity. We basically are here. We will never die, which is really nice. You know, we don't have to worry about retirement for the community foundation. We invest about 65% of the assets in equities and 35% in fixed income investments. And we have six local banks that handle all of our investments for us. They each handle about $3.5 to $4 million.
You took over what year?
I started working in 2012. Amy Owen, my predecessor, had been there for 10 years. She did a phenomenal job for the Community Foundation. And when she decided to move to Virginia in 2011, I was working down in Winchester at a very small startup Community Foundation there, and I applied for her job and was hired here.
So you guys switched states.
We did actually switch states.
It seems like you've been here for a very long time, but I guess 7 years starts to become a very long time.
Yeah, before that I served on the board because I got involved with the Community Foundation back in 2002 when they started to do some events. I had a background in events and they asked me to serve on their PR committee, and then eventually I went on the board. And so I've been involved with the Community Foundation for a very long time.
What were the assets worth when you took over?
When I took over in 2012, we had about, I want to say it was close to $14 million in assets.
And it's grown to 23.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Well, let's talk about the tax laws. Now, that's may or may not impact the Community Foundation, if not here, maybe all around the country in different community foundations. Have you noticed anything one way or the other?
Well, you know, it's real hard to say with the Community Foundation because so much of our charitable giving, people make contributions to us for, is driven by something completely other than taxes. It may be an estate plan that they've created, and when they pass on, we will get some money. We've got a couple of gifts that are coming in the next 2 or 3 months that are from estates. People who want to give to the Community Foundation are still doing it regardless of whether the tax implications are better or worse for them. What we are finding is that some people are bundling their gifts. They may decide to give us a substantial amount of money 1 year, and it will go into their donor-advised fund. And then over the next 2 or 3 years, they will have us make distributions from that fund to their favorite local charities. They get the tax write-off in the 1 year. They're able to itemize their deductions that year. And then in the next couple of years, they're going to actually just use the standard deduction and then, you know, do it all over again.
And a donor-advised fund is?
A donor-advised fund is a fund where the individual or family who creates the fund makes recommendations of where the grants are distributed.
So I want to start a scholarship fund for minority student college funding, for example.
That's a scholarship fund.
Okay.
Different.
Right.
Because
it's different.
Yeah. The scholarships have a lot of different guidelines that we have to follow because of H.R. 4, the Pension Protection Act of 2006. Scholarships were grouped into kind of a special category. To make a long story a little bit short, what was happening is some people were creating scholarship funds at the charitable arms of some of the larger investment houses. And then they were giving their grandchildren scholarships from those funds. And they were, and that's not legal. You really can't do that. So
that's a good thing I didn't do that.
Yeah.
Because I've got the grandgirls at college age, and
kind of the reason why you were asking that line of questions.
I'm sure it was.
To begin with,
what to
right
do with my millions is always it's a daily topic.
This is not Michael's first day on the job. He saw right through you.
Exactly.
But what happened is community foundations were grouped into that as well as far as scholarships. So we have a lot more restrictions. We have to have our own committee that makes the recommendations for the scholarship recipients.
I see. So the scholarship fund is different than a donor-advised fund.
Yeah.
What would fall into that the donor-advised fund category?
Well, a donor-advised fund can be established by anybody. It can be an individual. It can be a business. We've got a great donor advised fund that was established by City National Bank back in 2009 with a $100,000 gift. And every year their employees recommend small grants throughout the Eastern Panhandle. About $6,000-$7,000 in grants each year come from that fund. We have an individual, a family who came in, established $1 million donor advised fund with us, and they'll distribute about $50,000 a year from that fund. We will actually take their recommendations. We look at the nonprofit organizations, verify that they have charitable registration with the Secretary of State and that they have a 501c3, and then we will go ahead and cut a check.
I wonder, and maybe you can, this might be a personal feelings question one way or the other, as I think about some of the funds I'm sure you have are in place to exhaust the entire fund and someday expire. That's the choice of the person who's in charge of the fund or who donated the money. Others are meant to go on in perpetuity in an endowment type state. And I think of endowments, I think of some of the universities in this country that have huge endowments and they generate scholarship
Harvard.
Money. Yeah, what is it, $1 billion or something to that effect that generates money?
Don't get off track here, but I mean, it's so much money that I have heard they could fund every Harvard student 100% for the next 100 years.
Right, right. And I'm wondering, if you added up all the money that's tied up in endowments in this country, are we better served just expending that money and helping the people who need the help now? Or are we better served kicking off a smaller percentage of that money each year to fund smaller chunks of scholarships to people who need help or whatever the aid might be used for? Any thoughts on that?
It absolutely depends on the donor. You know, I mean, the donor drives what happens with the money that they give us. And mm-hmm. I think I have to kind of look at, if you think about Social Security and Medicare, if the money that we as employees and as employers put into those programs years ago had been invested rather than spent by the government, mm-hmm. there'd be a lot of money to support those programs.
There would be an unbelievable amount of money.
And that is the kind of philosophy that we have at the Community Foundation, that we will invest the money, we will make distributions based on the investment gains. We distribute roughly 5% annually. Last year, we did $1.8 million in grants and scholarships that were awarded. It was more than the normal amount because we awarded $1 million grant to the Berkeley County Parks and Recreation for another building down in the South Berkeley Recreation Center, the W. Randy Smith Family
Fund.
Right,
right.
But it's the kind of thing that we feel real strongly about. Endowment is better because we are able to make grants in perpetuity. And we are able to grow. I mean, the other thing that's great about a community foundation is we get 1% from each of the fund annually. Each of the 220 funds that we have pays the community foundation 1% annually to handle the administrative expenses. As the community foundation grows and we have more assets, we have more money to cover our administrative expenses. We have very little fundraising that we do. Mm-hmm. In fact, all of the events that we have, and we have four really nice events annually, have no ticket price. We invite the students to come to a scholars and donors reception. We invite the nonprofit organizations that are receiving grants from us to come to a reception where we announce the grants. We have an event where we recognize our past leaders and award a whole series of summer grants that are given. It's a lot of different things that we do each year that we don't have to go out and raise money. And one of the things that we would love to see is every nonprofit organization in the Eastern Panhandle of West Virginia to have $1 million endowment with us so that we could spin off $50,000 a year to help them cover their administrative expenses, or at mm-hmm. least a portion. Because what happens is so many of the small nonprofit organizations spend too much of their time fundraising rather than focusing on their mission. And we feel terrible when we see that happen, because it is really a sad situation when a great nonprofit organization is just really barely getting by because they've got to raise their entire every year, and the operating budget has to be raised each year. So that's where we really feel that the model for community foundations is very successful.
So if your funds are worth $23 million, then $230,000 would be your operating budget.
Correct. It's a little bit more than that. We have what we call partners in philanthropy, businesses in the community that support our operations as well. Mm-hmm. And we have some other donations that just come in to help support operations. Our budget's about $250,000, $260,000 a year.
Michael, is there something, let's say, that's going on right now or very recently that you're most proud of? I mean, do you have kind of something that you just think that you're really making an impact out there in the community, or is everything all wonderful?
There are two really cool programs that we do. There's a lot of great work that we do, but two that have become very successful. One is what we call the mini grants to teachers. And it was inspired by a community foundation leader down in Beckley, a woman named Susan Landis, who passed away a couple years ago. And Susan had told me about this back in 2013, said, this is a great program. We give little $500 grants to teachers, real simple application. We love the idea so much that we put it together here. And we were able to award $44,000 in mini grants to teachers last year. We've been growing that program each year, but those are up to $500.
Share some details. How does that work? You're a teacher, you apply.
Exactly right. We have a one-page application. A teacher can apply in an hour. They tell us what they need for their classroom. A cover of our most recent annual report has a photograph of kindergartners. These are students at Warm Springs Elementary School in Morgan County. It's an amazing program because the teacher asked for little tablets for these kids to work with. And what was fascinating is...
It's a great picture, by the way.
Isn't it
it's a great picture.
Our grants committee had some real tough questions. They were like, do kindergartners really need tablets? And is that something that we really want to get involved in? And they decided, let's see what happens. So it was a $489 grant. She went out and bought these 6 tablets and the keyboards and the headphones. She got a great deal on them. And when she started the program, these kindergartners, when they started, I believe the beginning of the year, only about 11 of her 20 students were at level. And at the end of the year, 17 of them had, jumped up to first grade level, basically. And she attributes a lot of it to these tablets. And what we thought when we saw this photo, it was fascinating to see these little kids totally focused on working on problems that they could solve themselves working with these tablets. We have funded everything from a garden program to a...
For teachers, we're still on teachers.
Yeah, teachers, yeah. Little, mm-hmm. Little... $500 indoor garden kind of thing that the teachers have applied for. It's really amazing what they're able to do, how much good they can do with a small grant. So that's a great one.
So many of them end up supplementing what they need to do in the classroom with their own salary.
Spend so much money, and that's one of the things.
That's a great program.
That we're able to help with.
So, and another one, you said there was another program.
Scholarship program is amazing because even though we give small scholarships, our scholarships range from $500 to $5,000. Not a lot of money by any...
$5,000 is a pretty good
but when you look at what college costs these days, it's not a drop in the bucket. But we've learned over the years that even though they're small amounts, that there have been great impacts from these scholarships. And we got a wonderful email about 6 months ago from a young lady who had just graduated from WVU. And she said, if I hadn't gotten the two $500 scholarships from you and a couple of other ones, I wouldn't have been able to go to WVU. I wouldn't have been able to graduate. And I wouldn't have gotten my dream job. She is working in the front office for the New York Mets. And so she sent us a picture in her little Mets uniform.
That's awesome.
And she came and she spoke at our scholars and donors reception.
Very nice.
Her name is Jamie Shrewsbury. She's from Martinsburg. And interestingly, 2 years ago, we gave her one of her sisters a scholarship. And this year, her younger sister got a scholarship. And they were teasing. They've got one more who's just 13. So it'll be 4 years before we see an application from her. But it's a great program. We interviewed 39 students for these scholarships over a two-day period in April. And it's truly inspirational seeing some of the great talent that are coming out of the public school systems in the Eastern Panhandle.
When you interview for these scholarships, and there's a lot of them available,
right,
I would imagine.
We have 44 different scholarships.
So when you're interviewing, are most of them on a need basis or on a talent basis or on a scholarly basis or all of the above?
Yes, all of the above.
Okay.
And some of them are on needs basis. Some of the scholarships are strictly scholarship. Others are a combination of both. We've got one, the Martinsburg, the Rotary Club of Martinsburg, the Noon Club established one in honor of N. Blaine Groves, a doctor that was...
That's where they do the essay contest or something.
Yeah.
Isn't that the one where they award a scholarship based on...
No,
your,
that's different.
That's a different one.
They have
okay.
a separate series of scholarships that they do for Interact students.
Okay.
But this is one, it can be any student from the Eastern Panhandle. And it is on community service primarily, as well as academic excellence, and it is not needs-based. So it's kind of nice because we get a lot of kids who really, you know, it's fascinating. If you're really rich, your parents pay for college. If you're really needy, you're able to get Pell Grants and other mm-hmm. scholarships and grants based
on needs. Yeah, if you're at the top of the economic scale or the bottom, you have avenues that those in the middle don't have.
Exactly. And when you're in the middle, it can be tough.
Sure.
I mean, it can be really hard, and we would love to see the students end up with a four-year degree without any kind of debt, and we can help a little bit.
How can people apply for these scholarships? Michael, as you said, there are 44 different donor funds, so...
We have a single application, and on the front of the application are tick boxes.
Where do you get it, though? Where do
they're
you
online, ewvcf.org, and the applications go online in November.
Mm-hmm.
And they're online until 1st of March when the application deadline.
So the ones that have been awarded for this upcoming academic year have already been awarded.
Yep.
Okay.
We had our award ceremony on May 10th.
All right. So now you start a new round in November, and that would be for the academic year 2019-2020.
Correct.
I see.
Yeah.
What's the largest collegiate scholarship that might be given out?
For us, it's $5,000.
Is that per year or is that over 4 years?
It's over 4 years.
Over four years.
We split the big ones up over 4 years. And the reason we do that is a lot of students get that first year pretty well covered by a series of scholarships. They may get 3, 4, 5 scholarships. It'll cover most of the first year. We like to let them know that they're going to get $1,250 a year from the Jake scholarship.
Do you do that by $625 a semester then? Or?
Yep. It depends on the school. Some of the schools like it in a lump sum, and then they credit it by semester. We will sometimes send it by semester as well.
Now, what counts most in a lot of these scholarships?
You only have 30 seconds left.
Personal interview or essay?
Yes, both are very important, and we don't interview everybody who gets a scholarship.
Okay.
Very nice. Michael, how can people find out more about the Eastern West Virginia Community Foundation?
They can look for us on the website, ewvcf.org. There's all kinds of great information there, or call us at 304-264-0353.
Good stuff as always, Mike.
Thank you very much, Rob.
Good to see you.
Nice to see you.
Thanks for coming in. It's 9 o'clock. Our news break is coming up next. This segment of Eastern Panhandle Talk with Rob and Dave was brought to you this morning by the Brown Funeral Homes and Cremations, family-owned, full-service funeral home, helping people around our area since 1880. This is Talk Radio WRNR Martinsburg.
This is CBS News on the Hour, sponsored by Zoom Video Conferencing.
I'm Deborah Rodriguez. Right after ABC canceled her hit show, Roseanne Barr apologized for a racist tweet about a former Obama administration advisor and said she was leaving the social platform. Didn't last long. Her thumbs were working overtime through the night.
Roseanne Barr was active on Twitter, retweeting many comments suggesting that canceling her show was far too drastic an action. Barr also attempted to explain how her racist tweet came about in the first place, blaming it at least partially on the sleep-inducing drug Ambien. It was 2 a.m. I was Ambien tweeting, she says. At the same time, Barr tells her followers the tweet is indefensible and says losing her show is zero compared to being labeled a racist.
CBS's Steve Futterman. 2,000 people have been evacuated in the mountains near Asheville, North Carolina. Officials are worried the Lake Tahoma Dam will give way after it was hit by a landslide.
It's a surprise and a shock because I've never seen that much water in one place at one time.
Many people rescued from high water after days of heavy rain. New focus on possible obstruction and the Russia investigation. Correspondent Stephen Portnoy.
Sources tell CBS News the special counsel has grown increasingly interested in the past couple of months in whether the president obstructed justice by pressuring Attorney General Jeff Sessions. The New York Times reports Robert Mueller is particularly focused on a March 2017 meeting at Mar-a-Lago, at which Mr. Trump is said to have urged Sessions to reverse his recusal from the Russia probe. Attorneys for the president say that would have been a legitimate exercise of his power.
The LAPD is reaching out to thousands of current and former USC students who say they were sexually abused by former college gynecologist George Tyndall, Assistant Police Chief Beatrice Germala.
We are empathetic and ready to listen. We cannot do this without your help.
If your kid's not doing well in school, maybe it's the weather. Live to CBS's Gary Nunn.
Research by Harvard University documents a significant link between higher temperatures and lower school achievement. AC is the key, says study co-author Joshua Goodman.
It may be that we've been ignoring the physical comfort of students too much in this country.
The study also finds the impact of heat and hot weather is greater on students from lower-income families and ethnic minorities, often because they are in schools that lack adequate air conditioning. Deborah?
Consumers and businesses weren't spending as much in the first quarter. The Commerce Department says the economy grew at a rate of just 2.2%. That's a little less than analysts expected. S&P futures are up 9, Dow futures ahead 119. This is CBS News.
Zoom video conferencing, featuring video and audio clarity with screen sharing. Free accounts are available at Zoom.us. That's Zoom.us. Zoom video conferencing.
Doors are being slammed in your face, and bad credit is holding you back from buying a house, car, even getting a credit card. $99 can put your credit back to a 720 or higher. That's right, just $99. Bankruptcy, tax liens, judgments, and even late pays can be removed from credit reports by calling the Giving Days Foundation. A nonprofit organization is here to help. Federal law allows you to challenge each and every item on your credit report. We'll recalculate your personal credit score for only $99 and repair your personal credit for free. Just be one of the first 10 callers. Take our personal credit challenge. Get your credit score to a 720. 800-482-4094. Call now to recalculate your personal credit score for only $99 and repair your personal credit for free. Call now. 800-482-4094. Don't miss this great free credit repair. Just be one of the first 10 callers. 800-482-4094.
Now your local news from Talk Radio WRNR. 29-year-old Jose Castro, also known as William, who is from El Salvador, faces up to 20 years in prison and a fine of up to $1 million after he pled guilty to one count of conspiracy to distribute cocaine. He admitted to selling the stuff during May of 2016. The FBI and the Eastern Panhandle Drug and Violent Crimes Task Force investigated the case. West Virginia First Lady Kathy Justice is visiting Mountain Ridge Intermediate School in Jarrettstown today to read to the fourth grade, and she'll also be at Eagle School Intermediate in Martinsburg to read to the third grade. Her visits are to kick off the Scholastic Summer Reading Challenge, a free online reading program. The city of Martinsburg released a statement regarding the discharge of fireworks within city limits. They say it's still prohibited year-round, and complaints about violations should be reported to the Martinsburg Police Department by calling 304-264-2100. I'm Adam Boardman, Talk Radio WRNR News.
Our last few days of May, definitely all about a summertime look and feel, as we've got a weather pattern very typical of June, July. Lots of humidity coming up out of the south. We've got a warm front that'll be coming through here during the daytime today. That'll kick off some rain in the afternoon, especially some showers and thundershowers more likely then, and a high temperature close to 80 degrees. Overnight, a lingering shower or thundershower, especially before midnight, with lows close to 68. And then tomorrow, on the warmer side of the front, more numerous showers and thunderstorms again, primarily afternoon. Daytime high, lower 80s. Muggy on Friday, partly sunny. Highs, upper 80s. I'm Bob Kukin, Talk Radio WRNR.
With four new car dealerships and four used car dealerships in three states, Parsons is the largest used car and fastest growing new car dealer in the tri-state area. Take Parsons Ford. With huge savings on hundreds of new Fords, financing from 0%, Parsons' goal of financing for all, and Parsons' famous above market trade-in allowances that help make Parsons number one for used cars too. See why so many won't buy anywhere but Parsons Ford in Martinsburg. We became number one by making you number one first. Parsons.
This is Joe Ferretti of Hammer, Ferretti & Schiavone. The laws are changing drastically in West Virginia, and more than ever, you'll need an attorney with a reputation and a history of good results handling your personal injury claim. At my law firm, each attorney has at least 28 years of experience winning cases. Ask about our reputation and history of proven results. We know these comparisons will convince you to call Hammer, Ferretti & Schiavone at 264-8505. Call for a free meeting to discuss your case. And of course, you can find us on the web at hfslawyers.com.
With four new car dealerships and four used car dealerships in three states, Parsons is the largest used car and fastest growing new car dealer in the tri-state area. Take Parsons Ford. With huge savings on hundreds of new Fords, financing from 0%, Parsons' goal of financing for all, and Parsons' famous above market trade-in allowances that help make Parsons number one for used cars too. See why so many won't buy anywhere but Parsons Ford in Martinsburg. We became number one by making you number one first. Parsons.
Welcome back to the program, Eastern Panhandle Talk with Rob and Dave in the 9 o'clock hour, brought to you this morning by Farmers and Mechanics Insurance Companies. When it comes to your home, auto, farm, or business, we're trusted, reliable, and experienced at Farmers and Mechanics Insurance Companies. Mr. Welch.
Good morning to you. Nice to have Michael in. Lots of good information today, I thought.
Yeah, we don't scholarships. We don't see Michael as often as we need to.
My daughter Laura already texted me listening to the show saying that she's going to get her Emily involved in those applications.
Yeah, that's the last piece of information there, Key. The scholarship window starts to open in November and it closes in March so that they can do the awards in time for fall tuition payments for college, which typically start sometime in the summer, whether you're taking an early summer course or you're enrolling for the fall when the bulk of your money is due in late July or August.
Yeah, and he's absolutely right. There's so many smart kids, good kids, coming out of these high schools in the Eastern Panhandle. And many of them, you know, either have earned, you know, the right to have a scholarship or are in need or both. And what a great way. 44 scholarships, 44 kids are going to be helped this year, starting when they go back to school in August/September. In part because the Eastern, Foundation,
West Virginia Community, it's a mouthful.
It's a long word, has helped out.
Hey, again, a reminder, many ways to catch our show live, of course, on FM 106.5 and AM 740 and online at talkradiowrnr.com, on the television, on Comcast Cable TV Channel 10 with video, and also on our app for your mobile device, too. You can catch the replays on our website at talkradiowrnr.com. You can link to it off of our Facebook page. And most days, when I'm attentive enough, you can catch the WRNR TV YouTube replay of the show. Now, yesterday, I actually forgot to turn the show off. And about 11:45, I remembered that I had forgotten to shut off the recording. But by that time, the file was so large, I couldn't upload it. So if you were looking for yesterday's replay on WRNR TV on YouTube, it wasn't there, and that's totally on me.
But you only have a million things to do, and it's easy in the morning, so it's kind of easy to forget. You know, and by the way, we've gone a whole hour today, and we haven't even talked about Roseanne Barr. I'm kind of proud of that.
Yeah, well, maybe we can keep that streak going.
Keep that streak going, baby.
For a little while there, too.
We don't need to talk about her.
I just got a note from Sherry saying the streaming is down, so we'll work on getting that fixed. And Sherry, I'm sure, is on that right now. In this segment, courtesy of the WVU Medicine Jefferson Medical Center talk line, is the West Virginia Education Association President Dale Lee, who we spoke with numerous times earlier this year. Dale, good morning. Thanks so much for being with us.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
Can I add one title to Dale Lee's name?
Basketball coach?
No. My one title I would add to Dale Lee's name, leader of a national movement.
Possibly true, huh? Dale, it
I
looks
like basketball. I kind of like basketball coach.
Where did you coach, Dale?
I coached at Bramall for 3 years and then at Princeton.
Princeton as in university?
No, Princeton High School in Mercer County.
Princeton University would have been a heck of a job to walk away from.
Yeah, that would have been tough to walk away from, but
because I think if you work there, you get to your kids get to go to school free there.
Oh, that would be great.
Oh, that would be nice if they can get in.
Yeah, you gotta
the only
get
problem
in.
With coaching at Princeton University is you'd have 12 guys smarter than the coach. Usually,
it might be true.
that would be true if I were the coach.
Dale, I'm sure you've been noticing the national movement and the raises that states have been giving to teachers. What does that indicate to you going forward?
Well, it tells me that teachers have finally found a voice. That I think Joe Thomas, the president of the Arizona Education Association, said it best when they asked him if West Virginia teachers gave them hope out there. And he replied, no, they made us believe. And belief is so much stronger than hope, which is true. We've made a nation believe that you have to stand up for public education, that you have to have your collective voices heard, and not only just in the action that you're taking, but then in the election process, because everything about your job is decided by the political process with the legislators in Charleston, and we have to make sure that we have a collective voice heard in these elections.
Dale, let's stay on the legislators in Charleston just for a moment, because so much has happened there. So many decisions were ultimately made. I think the general public thinks they were good decisions, and the outcome was good for teachers. I'd like your thoughts on whether or not the legislative leadership or even the legislature itself values education as a key component in economic development and ultimately in attracting new businesses and jobs to West Virginia?
I don't think they have in the past, but I think with what we did in March, by truly deciding to make an investment in education instead of just trying to skirt around the edges of partially funding it. But once you make an investment in education, you will see economic growth. Most companies that relocate, the first two questions they ask is how the roads and the infrastructure and how's the education system. If you have a great education system, and we have a good one, but what does it say to a company coming to West Virginia when they hear the fact that just in October we had 727 positions without a certified teacher in them? They're not going to want to relocate to a place that has that shortage, and so you have to make that investment. And I believe that for the first time, Governor Justice and the House particularly decided to make the investment. Now, that being said, you can't make a one-year investment and then forget about it for the next several years. When you're investing for your future, you don't make your initial investment to retire and then say, oh, that's enough, and forget about it forever. You have to make yearly investments, and that's what we have to do in this next legislative session. We have to continue that investment.
Oftentimes, naysayers of public education in West Virginia will point to our relatively low ratings on a national basis in terms of however schools get rated on a national basis. Let's say we rank 48th or whatever it might be. What can the West Virginia Education Association, your organization, do? I understand your advocacy for better conditions, better pay for teachers. Do you do anything beyond that to attempt to improve the education system generally? Do you work with the legislators or the governor in those other kind of capacities as well?
Well, we're not as bad as what the media would present that we are. As a matter of fact, we're in the top five in the nation in the high school graduation rate. We're almost at 90% in, statewide in high school graduations, and that's one of the top five in the nation. We are the leader in the nation in our preschool program. We're recognized nationally as the leader in our preschool program. Just a few years ago, we were second in the nation in the increase in the number of students that took and passed the AP exams. We have some great things going on in our West Virginia schools, but we tend to focus on the negatives on one single test score rather than look at all the positive things that are going on. We have groups that won national awards for robotics in middle schools and things like that. I mean, there's some really great things going on in West Virginia schools. We just tend to focus more on the negatives. Now, of course, we're going to continue to work with the legislature and the State Department of Education to make improvements in education. But when to do that, you have to go to the experts, and the experts are the teachers and service professionals who deal with this every day. They know more how to make improvements in education than a politician, than a bureaucrat. So we try to make sure that their voices are heard.
Dale Lee is our guest here on Eastern Panhandle Talk with Rob and Dave. He is the president of the West Virginia Education Association. Dale, yesterday we had Jason Huffman on the program from Americans for Prosperity, West Virginia. And Dave asked him about the tie-in between education in the state and economic development. And as Jason progressed through the question, he had this comment. I want you to hear that and then comment on that if you would.
Obviously, it's paramount to the future of our state. As we've seen, our state is lagging behind in education, sadly so. One of the statistics that always pops out to me is at the same time period that our per pupil enrollment has gone down 10%, which is the basis for all of the funding for education. Non-teaching staff, the employment for that has gone up 13%, if I've got my numbers correct. So it seems to me that we have sort of a system in which we're not prioritizing, again, from a fiscally responsible standpoint on the part of administrating how we do education in this state.
That's Jason Huffman, again, from Americans for Prosperity, West Virginia. He's the state director. Is what Jason said accurate, Dale?
In some places, I'm sure it is accurate. In some places, we do have an abundance of administrative jobs, but I'd have to really look down at where those jobs are. If you're looking at your increase in administrative jobs, TIS positions or technology specialists and things like that, because those don't fall under the classroom teacher category. You know, with so much technology we're using in the classrooms today, you have to make sure you have people who keep that running. I'm sure in some counties there are a larger number of administrative positions than there needs to be, but overall, it's not that great in what we've seen. But we really do need to concentrate the focus on the teaching positions. In other words, we have lost enrollment, and what's happened because we have the class size requirements in K through 6, and you have to have that. I mean, educationally, that makes sound sense. But what's happened is you've started losing a lot of the electives in the secondary schools. And, you know, we need to fund the electives. We need to find ways to keep every child's interest, whether it be in the arts or vocational programs or things like that.
Were you in favor of the Department of the Arts being folded into the Department of Education?
I really haven't paid a lot of attention to that. I know the original Arts and Education Secretary position was put in under Governor Caperton, and had we passed a constitutional amendment in the early 90s to do away with the State Department of Education or the State Board, that would have been the measure you'd take. But it's, you know, we want to maintain the arts, but the State Department can really do their job and do the trainings that are needed for that.
Let's talk about PEIA. I know we've had some forums around the state where people had an opportunity to show up at these.
I'm coming to Martinsburg, I think June the 9th.
Indeed.
Yeah.
How is this going, and are we gathering the right kind of information that will help us make an educated
solution, to come up with an educated solution to this issue.
Absolutely. We're gathering the right information. I mean, a lot of the stuff we knew, but to hear it over and over and over at every place we've gone, and I've now done six of these public hearings. I have three more to do. But particularly in the border counties, it doesn't make sense that we're expecting people to drive 3.5 hours when you can drive 30 minutes and get the same quality of care. That's true over in the Eastern Panhandle. It's true in southern West Virginia. It's true in many cases along our western border. So we want to make sure that that's done. And then, you know, it doesn't make sense that a bureaucrat is telling you what medicines you should take rather than the doctor. So those are all problems that we thought we knew we had. It's now confirmed, and we want to make sure that we come up with some great solutions to these problems. And, of course, it's funding, too. I mean, when you can't continue to fund the health insurance on the backs of the employees. You have to have a dedicated source of revenue for that.
That was part of the "we need to fix PEIA" cry that we right. heard in the teacher walkout this past winter and spring. So, do we have a definition of what would qualify as fixing, quote unquote, PEIA, Dale?
Well, fixing it is a number of things, and we ask this. I ask this everywhere we go. What do they consider a fix? And a fix has to be, you have to provide a funding source to offset some of the costs of the medical rate of inflation. But when you do have an increase in the premium or out-of-pocket costs, you have to have salary increases to offset that. Healthcare is a national problem. I mean, it's not something that we can, quote, fix totally in West Virginia, but we can really make the plan better and look at a lot of different ways to make the plan better for our employees in West Virginia.
Dale, last year during the work stoppage and the negotiations for a higher pay increase for teachers and public employees, there was a cry that we often heard, which I think it went, "We'll remember in November." And right. as right. November, and I know it was meant like, if you don't give us our way, we'll remember in November. How has that, if at all, how has that changed now that the outcome was the 5% that you all felt was the right amount? Are teachers going to be excited or activated in these general elections? And if so, who will they be campaigning for or against generally?
Well, we've already seen it in the primary election. One of the most outspoken critics of teachers and public education in the Senate was Senator Carnes. And we supported Bill Hamilton in the race against him, and Hamilton beat him 63% to 37%. Carnes didn't carry a single county in that large senatorial district. So teachers went out to vote then, and we'll continue to go out in November and vote. What we're looking for are moderates who are going to move this state forward. I'm not so concerned about the letter after the name. What I'm concerned about is people who value education and want to put education, make the investment in education that you need and to move the state forward. But there will be definitely a big change coming up in November, because the teachers will remember. There's no question about that. Teachers and service personnel will have their voices heard at the ballot box.
So let me ask you then a question, hypothetical. I don't need to mention names, because there's probably a lot of them that would fall into this category. Let's take a Republican legislator running for re-election against a quality Democratic candidate. That Republican legislator, at the end of the day, came forward and voted for the 5% increase, but it took a lot to get him or her there. I mean, they supported the lower amounts of raises,
right.
In other words. In a general election, will the teachers be more willing to, more inclined, let's say, to say, hey, you know, it took a long time to get him or her to the table and do what we wanted, but eventually they came, and so they're okay with us? Or do you think it will be the other way, that said, we just don't trust that Republican because at first they were against us and we don't think they're going to be with us in the future, so we're going to go out and walk the precincts and work for the Democratic challenger? Where does that fall generally, do you think?
Well, you're going to look at their entire body of work. It was easy to vote for the pay the 5% at the end when you knew that's going to pass. I mean, it's easy to say, I voted for it. Well, tell me what you did before that. Tell me the things that you did. Tell me the bills that you tried to push. WVEA, we have an extensive process. We have a questionnaire that goes to every candidate. We review. We have very thought-provoking questions on the questionnaire. We review that. Our locals then interview the different candidates. So it very well may, in that hypothetical situation you were talking about, if they haven't consistently supported public education and it takes a lot of prodding to get them there at the end, then in that situation, it probably will be that you'll go to the opponent as long as their questionnaire shows that they're going to consistently support public education.
Will you be putting your organization or an organization affiliated with your organization, will you be putting resources into any of these campaigns around the state?
Oh, sure. Absolutely. I mean, we have a separate branch of our association. It's the West Virginia Education Association Political Action Committee, and we'll be making endorsements, and we'll be giving candidates some money to help out with their campaigns, as well as the boots on the ground. And that's the most important thing that we can do, is we can get out and knock on doors with people and send emails and phone calls and do the work that's needed to get pro-education candidates elected.
Dale Lee has been our guest, president of the West Virginia Education Association. Dale, before we let you go, can we expect another request of at least a 5% raise next year during the school year for teachers?
You're going to see another investment, absolutely. You can expect that.
Will 5% be your minimum target?
Well, I mean, we need to get salaries to competitive levels in a quick amount of time, and the 5% seems to be a good number for that.
Dale, thanks so much for your time this morning. Much appreciated.
Okay, thank you.
Dale Lee, president of the WVEA at 927, appearing courtesy of the WU Medicine Jefferson Medical Center talk line, David.
Yeah, I think that by his answer to some of those questions, I do think they're going to do everything they can to be activating that base of teachers out there in some of these competitive races.
This segment was brought to you by Bechtel Jewelers, West Virginia's largest Pandora retailer, Route 11 South Inwood, next to Viva Mexico. CPA Ken Apple joins us next.
Easy, take it easy. Don't let the sound of your own wheels drive you crazy.
Fire up the barbecues and the deals at the Miller's Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram Memorial Day sales events. Get great savings like $12,000 off a new 2017 Ram 2500 diesel or $10,000 off a new 2017 Jeep Wrangler Rubicon. Get the new 2018 Jeep Compass Sport for only $252 a month for 84 months or lease the new 2018 Chrysler Pacifica LX for only $365 per month for 39 months. Fire up the barbecues and the deals at the Memorial Day sales event at Miller's Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram, home of the lifetime powertrain warranty on Kelly Island Road, Martinsburg, and online at millerschryslerjeep.com. Stock number 17450, stock number 17113, stock number 18045, stock number 18170. All payments based on 3.9% APR and $3,000 down on approved credit. Taxes, tax, and processing fees extra. See dealer for details.
When you do the same thing for 135 years, you learn to do it well. For 135 years, we've been helping families through the hardest times of their lives. That's because we're a family as well. When your family loses a loved one, we're here to help. We're Brown Funeral Home in Martinsburg, Inwood, and Charlestown, Ranson. We're here when you need us.
Since 1877, Farmers and Mechanics Insurance Companies have proudly supported our local community. Farmers and Mechanics has the insurance products to meet your needs, including home, auto, farm, dwelling fire, business owners, and umbrella coverage. Please contact your local independent agency for a review of your insurance needs and ask for a policy from the company that knows you best. Farmers and Mechanics Insurance Companies, just off Edwin Miller Boulevard on Administrative Drive in Martinsburg. FMIWV.com.
The wellness
Wellness Center at Berkeley Medical Center introduces a healthy way of life. It's not just another diet, but a weight management program developed by the Wellness Center that includes metabolic testing, a simple 10-minute breathing test that determines how many calories your body actually needs, followed by working one-on-one with a health coach to develop a personalized mix of exercise and nutrition to tip the scales in your favor towards successful weight loss. A lifetime of good health awaits at the Wellness Center. For more info, call 304-264-1232.
This segment of the program brought to you by the Bank of Charlestown. We simplify your financial life. Member FDIC, equal housing lender. So you get a tune like this going. They call these evergreens. You know, they work no matter when. Even CPA Ken Apple is bopping in his seat as I roll this tune.
You know, and when you get Ken Apple up dancing,
when he's bopping,
it's got to have a good beat to it.
Certain je ne sais quoi.
What would they say in the old American Bandstand days, Ken, to this song? They give it a rating. Remember?
No.
Back in our day, man.
Got
Come
a good
on.
Beat. I can dance.
Got a good beat. You can dance to it. I like it. Give it a 9.
Kenny, are you telling me you don't remember American Bandstand, man?
I didn't watch that much.
You didn't watch American Bandstand? Come on. Theme song doesn't hit you? You don't know that theme song?
He was on Midnight Train, probably. Right?
You mean Midnight Special?
Midnight
Soul
Special.
Train. You're about
Soul Train. Train, yeah.
Okay. You're
I confused
club.
Confused. Combined two shows.
You're the king of the mixed metaphor, right?
I was thinking of that Midnight Train to Georgia.
Yeah, we got our hands cut out for us today.
Who sang that? Ken, who sang Midnight Train to Georgia?
Gladys Knight. Come on, Ken.
I asked Ken Apple.
He wasn't going to get it.
He's such a smart guy. I thought he'd get that. Did you know my mom used to be her secretary?
One of the pips? Oh.
No. She was Gladys Knight's assistant for
wow.
several years. Yeah,
that's impressive.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I was more into rock and roll than what was on American Bandstand.
That's more popular.
Oh, yeah?
Sure.
Yeah. Like British Invasion stuff?
Mm-hmm. Who was your favorite band as a teenager?
The Kinks. I'll bet it was the you loved the Kinks, I'll bet.
No. Chicago, Three Dog Night.
Yeah? I went to a Three Dog Night concert in L.A. once. One of the best concerts I ever went to.
It's the first concert I ever went to.
Three Dog Night?
Mm-hmm.
What was your favorite tune?
Probably Mama Told Me Not to Come.
Oh, that's a good tune for Three Dog Night, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
How about One is the Loneliest Number? Did they sing that?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
Number one.
No, one of the best concerts I went to, and one of my favorite groups most people have never heard of, was Uriah Heep.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
30 Days in the Hole, baby.
No.
They didn't do 30 Days in Uriah Heep, did
No.
You sure?
Mm-hmm.
I thought for sure they did. What was Uriah Heep's big hit, though?
You have to get your researchers on that.
What was their big hit?
They didn't have any big hits. They had a few that hit the top 40, but barely. Sweet Lorraine probably
Sweet Lorraine, right.
was the highest one.
Well, Ken, it's great to have you. You survived April, we see. Got through that. April 15th, 17th, came and went.
Always do, yeah.
Yeah. Do you take a vacation after that usually?
No, because April is a quarterly month, so all the quarterly payroll tax returns and everything are due. And what we usually do in a month, we have to do in April in a half a month, because I don't even look at any of that stuff till after all the returns are filed. So second half of April is just as busy as first half of April.
I did not know that. Okay, makes
sense.
And then
I spend the month of May doing all the last-minute people that came in right before April 15th that
okay.
we put on extensions. So,
right.
So all those are out. So.
But you do it with a smile.
Now I'm just waiting on the people that I put on extension that haven't brought their stuff in yet to bring their stuff
So
in.
Do you ever have a down month?
Yeah, I'd say November is probably my down month.
Okay.
Which works out because there's holidays, it's hunting season, so.
By the way, loyal listener Will says, Humble Pie was 30 Days in the Hole.
There you go.
That's the
Humble
one.
Pie, exactly.
I know I have that in there.
Very good.
Too.
Will is the, you never want to play Trivial Pursuits with him, I wouldn't think.
Unless he's on your team.
Yeah, well.
Then you go to James Rumsey, try to win a contest.
Right.
Right?
Yep.
All right, Ken, we are now.
He had me on his team 1 year.
How'd you do?
He didn't invite me back next year.
That tells you everything, yeah. doesn't it?
Tells me how he did. Yeah. We're 5 months into this tax year now.
Yes.
And what do we know so far about this tax plan?
Well, we know that for the vast majority of individuals, their taxes are lower, and that's been represented by their paycheck.
Okay.
Paychecks went up around the 1st of February for the new tax law reflected in the withholding rates.
So that happened in February, but it benefits you the entire tax year. You don't.
Correct.
When you file your taxes, January is not treated as a different animal.
Right. So you should get a little bit of a bump if you meet the criteria of most individuals. You get a little bit of a bump because January will still be taxed the same as the rest of the year, but you had higher withholding in January.
Right. So that brings me then to the end of the year question. So 12 months goes by, it's 2019, time to file our 2018 taxes. Fear number one I've seen online from people is, since they're withholding less, I'm afraid I'll owe more at the end of the year. Legitimate fear or not a legitimate fear, or is it fall into the Ken Apple depends column?
Always falls into the depends column, but it is a legitimate fear for a lot of people. The people that the idea is that you're going to have less withheld all year and you'll get the same refund next year that you got this year.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's the conventional wisdom, and it works for people who have always been taking the standard deduction.
Don't itemize.
Okay. Which is the vast majority of individuals. They've always taken the standard deduction. They're going to continue taking the standard deduction, and their standard deduction is approximately double what it used to be.
$24,000 now, right?
For a married couple filing joint under age 65, that's correct.
Okay.
So in their case, they'll have less withheld all year. They have a bigger paycheck, and when they file their tax return, they'll get the same refund approximately that they've been used to getting. Okay. Unfortunately for my business, that's not most of my clients. Most of my clients have not been taking the standard deduction.
I'm one of your clients. I do not take the standard deduction.
Correct. And for those people, it's a legitimate fear that my withholding is down and that may cause me a problem when I file my tax return. So what I'm encouraging everybody to do is take your last paycheck or your last retirement check, whatever you have withholding on that has been affected by this change, and either bring it to somebody like me or sit down with it yourself and project it to the end of the year and then plug it in and see what your tax is going to be and see what your withholdings are. And am I going to get a refund or is that going to cause me to owe money? Some of the reasons that you might owe money because of your lower withholding is probably the vast majority of my clients are using their withholdings to pay taxes on other income that nothing is withheld on. Okay. One of the most popular things, Social Security benefits.
Okay.
Okay. You can have federal taxes withheld from your Social Security benefits, but most people do not. So they either make estimated tax payments to pay that tax, or they have higher exemptions on their other retirement income or higher exemptions on their W-2 earnings. And that causes more taxes to be withheld, and that pays the tax on my other income. The other income that doesn't get taxed until the end of the year is investment income. So your dividends, your interest, your capital gains. A lot of people depend upon their withholdings to pay the taxes on that income. And if you're one of those people, then maybe you don't want your withholding taxes to go down because it's going to cause you a problem at the end of the year because you don't have the taxes withheld to pay the tax on that other income.
So it's not a matter of the taxes changing on the investment income. It's that you'll be having less withheld from your regular working wages.
Right.
Unless you go to your employer, if you're an employee, and have that adjusted.
You could do that.
That's correct. Some people, you might be an example of this, Dave, that have a business of their own in addition to the other income that you have coming in. You may be using your withholding to pay the taxes on that business income or rental income.
Yeah, I mean, I was kind of thinking of myself, which is nothing unusual, of course, around here. But I do have a small business, and I do have this job. And then next April, I turn 66. So I'll also have Social Security. So I'll have all three going on at the same time.
Right. Yeah.
So that's kind of interesting.
Yeah, okay. And that complicates things.
Yeah.
So it's, if you're not the cookie cutter individual that's just going to take the standard deduction, then you really need to put some thought into it and see whether you need to have more withholding. The other thing I've noticed with a few clients is if they had a W-4 on file with their employer and let's say they were to have extra taxes withheld, they were claiming single zero and take an extra $50 a pay out of my pay.
Yes.
A lot of employers, when the withholding tables changed, somehow that extra $50 got dropped. So they're just going by the new chart and not taking the extra money. So if you're having extra money taken out, make sure that you still are after February 1st when the new tables kicked in. The tables shouldn't have affected you, but apparently in some employers' HR systems, that got dropped when the new rates came into effect.
Let's say that you've just been happy taking home a bit more money and you haven't checked with your employer to find out if the single zero, take an extra 50 out, was erased or not. End of the year comes, we go see Ken Apple next year, and we find out we owe X amount of dollars. At what point does a penalty kick in for underpayment of taxes?
Okay, for on your federal return, is that $1,000? If you file your tax return and you owe less than $1,000 with your return, no harm, no foul, not even any paperwork to fill out.
Just send the check.
If you owe them more than $1,000, that's when they will want to charge you a penalty for not having paid as you go. Now, there's several ways to get out of that penalty, and that's where the other forms come into effect. You can fill out some forms and figure out whether you meet one of the exceptions to paying that penalty.
Okay, now, we haven't talked about state taxes yet. Not right. Estate, but the state you live in's taxes. How are those affected by the federal rate?
They're not affected by the federal rate at all. There were very little changes in the federal law that affect adjusted gross income, which is where most states begin the calculation for state taxes. So there wasn't a whole lot in the federal new law that's going to affect states, except for states that allow itemized deductions. So around here, we're talking about Maryland, basically, because West Virginia, Pennsylvania do not allow itemized deductions. Maryland does. Maryland's problem, which I have not yet seen reconciled, Maryland people were told that they were going to reconcile that, and I don't know, are they still meeting in Annapolis, or are they done?
I don't know the answer to that question. I think they're done, but I'm not 100% certain.
Okay, so the problem in Maryland is if you itemize deductions on your federal return, you may, if you like, itemize deductions on your state return. However, if you do not itemize on your federal return, you cannot itemize on your Maryland state return. So you are forced then to take the Maryland standard deduction, which is extremely low. So people in Maryland that are going to get caught, if Maryland doesn't do something, is people who have always itemized for federal and itemized for state, and now they're no longer going to itemize for federal anymore because the standard deduction went up so high that they're just going to take the standard deduction. Now when they do that, they're going to be forced to take the Maryland standard deduction, which will be significantly lower than their old itemized deductions were, and cause their Maryland tax to go up exponentially.
So if you don't have at least $24,001 to itemize, you'd be claiming, you'd be doing the simple, the standard.
Correct.
And that would, if you're a Maryland resident, which in this room one of the three of us would be, it could be held to pay on the taxes, is what you're saying.
Although I own a business in Maryland, does that count?
I don't know. Does it, Ken?
Probably not. I know we pay our share of, Maryland's got a nice way of taxing basically everything.
They really do. Yeah. They're very nice about that. Really.
Yes.
At the county or state level.
If you have Maryland source income other than W-2 wages, yes, it would affect you. Because you're going to be filing a Maryland non-resident return. And on a Maryland non-resident return, well, any state non-resident return, you calculate your tax as if you were a resident. And then whatever percentage of your Maryland income bears to your total income, that's the percentage of tax that you pay. So you would be in that same boat if you were forced to take the low standard deduction.
And I would imagine I'm not the only one that's listening to this program. I can think of several people who live in West Virginia and have businesses in Maryland or Virginia. So,
well,
that's just the nature of a four-state area.
Even if your business is located in West Virginia, you're likely filing non-resident returns in a couple of states because you're doing business in those other states. I mean, if you're a trade, if you're a plumber, an electrician, contractor, It's pretty tough to make your living around here, limiting yourself to only West Virginia.
Well, yeah, the other thing, and I don't know if this is relevant, the other thing that we face, too, is because we've got, I remember a couple of years ago, we had, in our little tiny little business, we had, Debbie does all the payroll, and she was doing payroll for one person in Virginia, one person in Maryland, one person in the District of Columbia, and another person, me, in West Virginia. So mm-hmm. she was doing four different you know, state payrolls and a very small staff.
Your wife is very skilled.
She is very skilled,
yeah, that's very common around here. And getting back to Maryland, if you're one of those people that's going to have a significantly higher Maryland tax because you're forced to take the standard deduction, there were no changes in the Maryland withholding tables. So you're still having the same taxes withheld that you had withheld last year for the state, yet when you file your tax return, you're going to owe more money.
Could be scary.
I believe the Maryland limit is $600. If you owe them more than $600, that's when they start to impose a penalty. So if they don't change it, which everyone seems to expect them to change their standard deduction to raise it, but if they don't, you could very well be caught in owing more than $600 and a penalty.
Democrats and very liberal Maryland Democrats are in control of the Maryland House and Maryland Senate. I suspect if they know a way they can get more money by not fixing it, they'll go with not fixing it. There's no danger of them getting voted out of office.
Well, but they have a Republican governor. Does that make any difference?
He can't make the laws. All he can do is sign them.
But he can, you know, threaten to veto, I guess. I don't know. I don't follow it that closely. It's so unusual to have a Republican governor in Maryland.
Can I borrow a for sale sign? Ken, there were ways in which the new tax laws helped balance some of the changes that took place, and that some of the child tax credits are some of the ways that they did that. Can you explain some of the new child tax credits that are in there, the new amounts, I should say?
Yes, and that goes to whether the increased or doubled standard deduction helps you or not. Okay, so if you've always been taking the standard deduction, the new standard deduction, of course, is going to help you. And it's going to help you to the extent that it outweighs the loss of your exemptions. Because that's what you gave up to get the higher standard deduction. You gave up the exemption deduction. Okay? Mm-hmm. So unless you have a significant number of children, what you gave up is going to be less than what you got from the new standard deduction. However, people who don't benefit from the new standard deduction are people who always itemized their deductions, and their itemized deductions have always been higher than $24,000. So if you're in that category, you don't care whether they raise the standard deduction or not. It doesn't help you at all. But your withholdings at work assume that it did help you. So those are other people that might get caught at the end of the year by having less taxes withheld, because they were having them withheld. Let's say their itemized deductions were always $25,000. They're going to be $25,000 again this year, which is higher than the new $24,000 standard deduction. So except for a small decline in their tax rates, their tax is going to be approximately the same as it was last year, but going to have less withheld. Okay. The other people, to your question, are folks whose dependents are not under age 17. Mm-hmm. Okay. So if you filled out a W-4 at work and you've claimed four exemptions, let's say for yourself, your wife, and your two children, but your two children are over age 17, they're not going to get the old $1,000 a year tax credit on those children or the new $2,000 tax credit on those children. But the withholding tables assume that those extra exemptions that you've claimed on your W-4 are going to be eligible for that credit. So that you have to look at also. Now, they did put in a new credit for children over 17, age 17 and over, but it's only a $500 credit. So it still won't match the reduction in withholdings at the end of the year.
And that credit would be, I would think, if it's for children older than 17, we're talking about kids in college or maybe those who even have graduated and come back to live at home because they haven't found a job or whatever.
Right.
All right. Hang out. We'll be back with another segment here with Ken Apple, and we're going to talk about some of the business tax law changes to qualified business income and new code section 199A. A nude code section is something entirely different in Texas.
Yeah, they only have those in Maryland.
California, too. This is Humble Pie taking us into the break here.
Life is complicated, but your finances shouldn't have to be. At BCT, we simplify your financial life. Bank of Charlestown is a locally owned community bank with 7 conveniently located offices serving the Eastern Panhandle of West Virginia, Middleburg, Virginia, and their newest office in Hagerstown, Maryland. With over 140 years of experience, BCT is the tri-state area's choice for fast, convenient, and hassle-free banking solutions. Whether you are a high school senior looking for a student checking account, a college graduate purchasing a new car, a first-time home buyer, or investing for retirement, BCT has flexible solutions to fit your lifestyle. BCT is committed to providing everyday ways to simplify your financial life. Also, make sure you are following BCT on Twitter and Instagram at MyBCT or like their Facebook page to see how BCT reinvests local deposits back into the communities they serve. BCT, we simplify your financial life.
Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Howdy, cowpokes. Yep, it's me again, your favorite Dusty Cowboy for Panhandle Printing and Design with more questions from the trail. Ever had the feeling while looking for help with printing that you're talking to a soon-to-be cattle rustler? Or do you feel like you're wandering around the corral looking for help only to find yourself talking to some young whippersnapper that don't know a Holstein from a Hereford? Well, then if you need printed material, you really need to go see my partners at Panhandle Printing and Design. They can help with everything from design to production of stationery, envelopes, business cards, invitations, final signs, banners, vehicle wraps, and a lot more. They'll treat you right and answer all the questions you have at your one-stop printing shop where they have something for everyone. Panhandle Printing and Design at 124 North Maple Avenue in Martinsburg. Call 304-267-7400 or find them online. I'm heading back to the bunkhouse, but if you need printing, it's time for you to head to Panhandle Printing and Design.
What do you think, Ken?
I'm impressed that you found that.
Always nice to walk down rock and roll memory lane with Ken Apple.
Tell everybody what this song is and who did it. What's the song, Ken?
It's Uriah Heep, Let the Party Carry On.
Sweet Lorraine.
Sweet Lorraine, Let the Party Carry On.
I understand you went to see Uriah Heep sometime in your young life.
Did, yeah. We went to see them at Harrisburg, Pennsylvania Farm Show Arena.
Nice.
I would have liked to have known Ken when he had a ponytail. How about you?
Did you have a ponytail, Ken?
No, my hair doesn't grow that way. I had an afro.
You hear your hair poofs.
Same thing.
It poofs.
Yeah.
At least it did, right?
Yeah, we stuck around after the show at the Harrisburg Farm Show Arena. We went around back and actually met the band, and they gave us guitar picks and nice. Drumsticks.
Wow.
Yeah, it was pretty neat.
That's pretty good. Most bands won't be given. First of all, they won't let you come around backstage.
Party on, dude.
Yeah, they greeted you nicely.
It was like an hour after the concert was over before they came out. But
it was worth the wait.
Hey, we were 16, 17 years old. We had nothing better to do.
Did you play in a band?
Not that kind of band, no.
Okay. Marching band.
High school marching concert, jazz band. Yeah. Yeah.
Were you on the Berkeley Springs High School marching band?
Absolutely.
All right.
What was your instrument of choice, sir?
I started out on trumpet, and the way it worked at our high school was they didn't have tubas in junior high school band. They didn't have those until senior high school band. So if you were a lousy trumpet player and you couldn't hit the high notes like me, they moved you to tuba.
So you actually played the tuba?
Yes.
Your senior year?
Last 3 years of high school.
Last 3, okay.
And I played tuba in the marching and concert bands at Shepherd, yeah.
Nice.
Well okay. Done, sir.
You went on to college with your musical talent.
Yeah, I actually did our senior year in high school, the senior concert, I did a solo on tuba, tarantella.
Was the Shepherd Band as...
You did the tarantella on the tuba?
I did.
Was the Shepherd Band as popular then as they are now? Because I know some people will... You know, I've never seen a school that will sit there during halftime and watch the band as much as they do at Shepherd during a football game.
I don't know if I noticed that.
Okay.
Hey, let's get into this final category before we end our program today. Qualified business income and new code section 199A here.
Yeah, I want to discuss that, but I don't want to leave the individuals without talking about what I heard you guys talking about earlier this morning.
Charitable?
These are the other people who are not going to win because of the new higher itemized deductions. And those are anybody who is deducting more than $10,000 of state taxes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's state income taxes plus state real estate taxes. And in West Virginia, Virginia, your personal property tax, that kind of thing. If they're over $10,000, you only get the first $10,000. And that affects more people than you would think.
It affects me.
And you don't have to be in a high-tax state like Maryland for it to affect you. It affects many of my clients in West Virginia have more than $10,000 worth of combined income and real estate taxes. Mm-hmm. So you got to look out for that. The other two things are these miscellaneous itemized deductions have all gone away. I shouldn't say all, but 95% of them have gone away. So that affects people who have significant employee business expenses.
Okay.
So if you're a salesman and you use your car a lot and you've been deducting all your mileage, that's not going to be deductible anymore. So that could cause you to owe money at the end of the year. And what I've been advising my clients to do is to work out a new arrangement with their employer for that, where they're reimbursed for their miles. Maybe take a pay cut and get reimbursed for your mileage instead. Mm-hmm. To preserve that deduction.
Sure, because the federal mileage rate's about 55 cents-ish.
54 and a half,
yeah.
And the last people that will see a change on that are people who pay a significant amount of investment expenses. So they have a significant amount of investment income, and they're paying somebody to watch that for them.
Mm-hmm.
Those fees have been deductible in the past, and they're no longer deductible.
Now we have about a minute to go here.
All right. So let's talk about qualified business income. What got all the attention with the new tax act was the lower corporate income tax rates. And that was the political ball that was thrown around, whether it should or shouldn't happen. And what they thought about when they were reducing this corporate tax rate so much is how it affected businesses that are not C corporations. So this new section 199A is basically a 20% reduction in your net income for people who have businesses that are not organized as a C corporation. So that would be sole proprietorships, partnerships, LLCs, S corporations. So basically the calculation there would be the same as always. Here's my net profit, but I'm only going to pay tax on 80% of that net profit. Now there's all kinds of exemptions to that, so you got to make sure that you qualify for it, but it's a significant deduction that you don't want to miss.
We'll go into our final minute of commercials here. This is Ken playing the trumpet back in his younger days here.
Oh, nice.
Or it's Al Hurt. I'm
glad they picked that up.
Not if they're hitting high notes. It's not me.
He's hitting some high notes there. 9:58.
Heroin addiction, overdoses, kids' futures at risk and growing up to become drug abusers. It's a national problem. Prevention can solve it, but where do we start? The Martinsburg Initiative is our police, school, community partnership and model solution to this national problem. It's based on the science of adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs, the traumatic experiences during childhood resulting in serious problems when they grow up. ACEs are caused by abuse, neglect, and household dysfunction, and they really matter. A child with 6 adverse childhood experiences is almost 50 times more likely to become a heroin user as an adult. A positive adult role model spending a few hours a month with a child can make the difference. A child with a mentor is 46% less likely to begin using illegal drugs. 46%. Mentors change lives. We need mentors. Change a life. Be a mentor. Call Project Director Tiffany Hendershot today at 304-267-3510. 304-267-3510.
So we have concluded our segment with Ken Apple, CPA, about some of the changes with the new tax information now that we've played it out 5 months here. Ken, how do people get in touch with you to discuss more of what we talked about today?
You can reach me at 304-263-1100.
263-1100, and they can find you on what street?
I am at 105 South Tennessee here in Martinsburg, West Virginia.
Thanks for the visit, sir.
Thank you.
Davey?
I will see you in.
Not yet. We're not there yet.
I will see you in.
I will see you tomorrow when we have, among others on the program, Paul Espinosa, delegate, and Kelly Tanksley from the Martinsburg Berkeley County Public Library System. This is Talk Radio WRNR Martinsburg. The Glenn Beck Show is next. Talk to you again in 22 short hours.
This is CBS News on the Hour.